Hi, my name is Dave O'Brien. I'm part of the security and risk team at Thirdera, a Cognizant company. Today, I'm going to review a few recent vulnerability response features related to exception management. This includes a couple of releases, both from November 2023, as well as February 2024. So let's get started. First off, I'm going to start with my remediation workspace, and we're going to talk a little bit about mitigating controls. So if I open up a remediation task here, something that's assigned to me, I can see I've got a vulnerable item in here and my current risk rating is set to high. Now, if I wanted to reduce that risk rating because of mitigating controls in place, I can go in and select to request an exception. And for my reason, I select mitigating control in place. Once I do that, I get an additional prompt that allows me to choose between requesting a deferral to say I'm not going to fix this for a period of time, or to choose to reduce the risk. I can request both at the same time if I want to, but in this case, I'm just going to request a risk reduction. So I'm going to uncheck the request for deferral. This again is going to show my current risk rating, which is set to high. And then for a desired risk rating, I can choose any rating that is lower than that high rating. In this case, we'll select it as a 4 or low. Then I can choose which compensating controls apply to this. So if I go in here and look at, I'll select encryption at rest and segmentation as example mitigating controls. I'll identify the date that I want to reduce this risk until. We're just going to push it out until the end of May. Let's say maybe after that, those mitigating controls are no longer applicable, or we just want to make sure that we're resetting that prior that risk back to a higher rating at that point. And then we're going to put in some justification notes. I'm just going to put mitigating control in place and then click to request an exception. Similar to the vulnerability exception request questionnaires that were released several releases ago, we can now do the same thing when requesting to do risk reduction through a compensating control as well. There is an available out-of-the-box set of questions that we can prompt for. That's what this is showing here. So it's things like describing the potential impact if the vulnerability were to be exploited. Some of these are required, some of them aren't. I'm just going to go ahead and fill out the things that are required. I'm going to say control in place. We're going to hopefully put some better data in here in the future. I'm just going to reference a KB article here. Reference for technical details. I'm going to say prevents access outside of segment. My evidence, I'm going to say, I'm going to reference a different KB article for my evidence. I could actually choose to attach supporting evidence as well, so I can add an attachment record here. Again, I'm just filling out the kind of the critical fields, and I'm just going to say not applicable for these two questions. And then I'm going to submit that exception questionnaire. So once I've submitted that, I can close this window. And if I come over to my state change approval record, I'll see that I have a new state change approval record in here saying that I'm choosing to or requesting to reduce that risk. And because there's a mitigating control in place, I'm requesting that until the 31st of May. And this will actually send off for approvals. Once approved, this will actually reduce the risk of the remediation task. And then once we hit that 31st date, then it'll go back to its original risk rating. So that's one great new feature to be able to kind of do that risk reduction. Now, another piece that was released, and I'm going to switch over here to my vulnerability manager workspace. So if I'm in as a vulnerability analyst and I want to limit either which mitigating controls can be used for specific vulnerabilities or whether the risk can actually be reduced or not, I can do that as well. I'm going to go ahead and just open up one of my vulnerability entries from Qualys here. This is through the vulnerability entry libraries TPEs link here. And within this, I've got two new buttons here. So the first is to associate controls. So if I do that, I can go in and I can select which compensating controls are actually valid for this particular vulnerability. So if I go in and choose IP whitelist and network access control, for example, and click submit, that's going to go ahead and add those. If I come over, I can actually see my applicable compensating controls as well on this related list. So what does that do? Now, if I go in and look at a vulnerable item that has this particular vulnerability, and I'm going to go and do that kind of same process, that request exception, select that it's a mitigating control in place, I want to do a risk reduction, we'll say we want to move it to a 3, you'll see I only have these two choices as compensating controls now. So it's limited down which controls I can select from. And you can do this for each individual vulnerability entry to limit kind of where those can be done. You can also choose to disable risk reduction completely with the disable risk reduction button. If I do that, it's going to go ahead and just say that it gives me a message that it's disabled here. And if I come back over to my same vulnerable item, and I go to request an exception, choose mitigating control in place, I actually get a notification that says risk reduction is not allowed. I can still submit this as an exception saying that I want to do a request to defer this for a period of time based on a mitigating control, but I can't actually reduce the risk. So a little bit of an extra control for our vulnerability analysts to determine kind of when and where those mitigating controls can be used. The next feature I'd like to cover is the ability to request an extension to an existing approved exception. So I'm going to switch back over to my IT remediation workspace, and I'm going to look at a remediation task that is already in a deferred state and has a deferral date that is through the end of May. So if, for example, I have a vendor that doesn't have a fix available and isn't going to by the end of May as expected, I may need to request to extend this exception. Prior to this new feature, we would have had to either reopen this exception and submit it as a new request, or wait for that February 31st date to come and go, wait for this to automatically reopen, and then request a new exception. So now instead, I can just click Request Exception. It's going to ask when I need to extend that until. I'm already extended out to May 31st, so let's push it to June 30th. Hopefully, we'll have a fix available by then. I'm going to go ahead and specify my reason as fix unavailable, and just specify that I'm still waiting for a vendor fix. And click to request an extension. This is going to prompt for an exception questionnaire, the same as it would if I was submitting a new request. I'm just going to go ahead and put not applicable for these so I can fill this out quickly and click submit. I'm just going to go ahead and submit that exception request to extend. This will go out to the approvals, the same approvers that we do for an exception request. If they approve it, then it's going to go ahead and update that until date. If they reject it, then it will still stay in a deferred state until the current date, which is May 31st. So this is a nice, easy way to be able to extend this. It applies to both vulnerable items and remediation tasks. You can also do an extension on an exception rule as well. So some great new features available when it comes to managing exceptions, as well as risk reduction through compensating controls. Thanks for watching this video. Please check out our other release notes videos and other ServiceNow content. Thank you.